please.
Mr. Biancamano?
Present.
Mr. Klupfel?
Here.
Ms. Markle?
Here.
Ms. McAllister?
Here.
Ms. Mitchell?
Here.
Mrs. Rhodes Kearns?
Present.
Ms. Sobolov?
Here.
And Dr. Gold?
Here.
This meeting is being held in conformity to the Open Public Meeting Act. Proper public notice of the meeting was published in the local papers on December 7th and December 8th, 2013. If any board member or member of the public in attendance believes that this meeting is in violation of the Open Public Meeting Act, the Hoboken Board of Education requests that they make a statement at this time. The board wishes to make those in attendance aware of this meeting is that this meeting is being recorded on video and will be broadcast by the board at a later date on cable television channel 77 and Fios channel 46. The Hoboken Board of Education is committed to preserving the decorum of the public process and is mindful that we live in the electronic age of computers, cell phones, and other electronic communication devices. Nevertheless, we respectfully request that all meeting participants kindly silence their electronic devices during the course of the meeting, and if use of the device is necessary, we ask that you please leave the meeting room and conduct personal business elsewhere. Mr. President.
Pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. Dr. Toback.
All righty. So in difficult budget times, many people question why schools have athletic teams. Some people question the value of team sports and what benefits the students receive by getting involved on an athletic team. Athletics serve a critical educational function that complements the teaching that takes place in every classroom. That's the primary reason why schools support athletic teams and continue to do so. While a state championship is a testament to the athletic skills of our student athletes, our AD, Mr. England, is also going to speak to you in a few minutes about the classroom connections and how that works for the betterment of all of our students. Athletics are a real life setting for many situations experienced in life after graduation. Practice of competition, the work ethic required to prepare well for competition are important keys to athletic success and keys to success in life. The ability to adapt to a variety of situations is a key to success in athletics. It's something that this team did marvelously. Cooperation with teammates, seeing the importance of the team above yourself, also keys to success. Great leadership skills are often developed by taking part in athletic programs. Is it simply coincidence that so many of our presidents and other leaders are involved in athletic competition? Everyone knows John Kennedy was a swimmer at Harvard University. Teddy Roosevelt was known for his boxing skills. Abraham Lincoln was well known as a wrestler. Ronald Reagan played football at Eureka College. Lyndon Johnson was a baseball player. Dwight Eisenhower was a football player at West Point. Gerald Ford played football for the University of Michigan when they won two consecutive national championships. Both dad and son Bush played baseball for Yale University. And everyone knows President Obama is a skilled basketball player. No coincidence. Athletic programs make a big difference in the lives of many people, even if you don't become president. Our Red Wing football team learned so much about all the things that I just mentioned. What is especially impressive to me is the ability for the team to adapt to a variety of circumstances and situations. The team overcame much to become state champs, and I don't want to talk where the coaches and where the athletic director is going to talk, but I want to congratulate our Red Wings, our state champ football team from Hoboken High School. Congratulations, boys. I'd like to also turn things over to Mr. England. He has some things that he would like to say about the football team, and then we're going to introduce the players.
Good evening. Dr. Toback, Board President Gold, and the rest of our esteemed board members, it gives me a great deal of pleasure to present to you the 2013 NJSIA North 2 Group 1 State Championship football team. Woo! Woo! However, before I turn the mic over to Coach Taglieri, I'd like to thank all of you, not only for your support of Hoboken football and Hoboken athletics as a governing body, but also for your physical presence at our games. The team and the coaches have noticed you at both home and away games, oftentimes braving the elements, as you did this past Saturday, and standing by our student athletes through their ups and downs that accompany all athletics. That support is greatly appreciated. I'd also like to thank Principal Picapetra and her administrative staff for everything they do for our athletes and our entire student body. From establishing the Academic Center for Excellence, headed by Mr. Huggins, to raising the academic and decorum standards for every student in our school, to something as trivial as helping to provide transportation to the game on Saturday. It is all noticed and greatly appreciated. That support and educational leadership has been invaluable to our student athletes, our staff, and the athletic department. This season has been incredible, and it culminated with an amazing victory on Saturday. However, it would be an injustice to this team and to the coaching staff if we only focused on Saturday's championship game. Interscholastic athletics are a microcosm of life. Athletes learn things every day about themselves and life in general, each game, every practice, and every coach they encounter. And our football players have been fortunate enough to learn invaluable life lessons this season, lessons that will eventually prove much more valuable and much more rewarding than a ninth state championship title. What most people notice is a great team, a great offense, a great defense, and some really skilled players that went out and beat a very good team from Shabazz. Some observers might appreciate the great coaching that helps develop this offense, this defense, and these players. However, what most people may not appreciate is the real-life education that Coach Taglieri and his staff give and the outstanding role models they are. Coach Taglieri and his staff are very humble. He's probably going to be really irritated that I'm doing this to him right now. He's going to give all the credit to his players. And don't misunderstand me. The players deserve a lot of credit. They go out and they make the plays. They are outstanding young men and represent our athletic program, our school, and our entire community extremely well. They deserve all the accolades they receive. However, I'd like to speak briefly about what our coaches do for our athletes. They teach and model responsibility, accountability, dedication, sacrifice, delaying gratification, overcoming adversity, respect for self, respect for others, positive communication, and that hard work is rewarded. They emphasize the importance of being a student athlete, how academics come before football. You will often hear our coaches and players refer to their team as family. They indeed treat every member of their squad like a member of their family. There is genuine concern, care, and love that our student athletes and coaches share with one another. It's a beautiful thing to observe. I could speak at length about the many life lessons I witnessed this staff impart on our student athletes over the past year. How when Coach Taglieri, last year's Hudson County Coach of the Year, had surgery mid-season and had to miss some time, his staff picked up the slack, like a true family would do, and they didn't make any excuses. They just kept marching on. They had a job to do, and their responsibility was to prepare our team to the best of their ability. They taught our student athletes that when something goes wrong, you don't make excuses and you don't quit. You work hard and you pick up the slack if that's what you're required to do. It's not surprising that this team was able to win a championship without five of its starters last weekend. Their coaches gave them the blueprint on how to overcome adversity by doing it themselves. There are several examples of what our student athletes were able to accomplish and learn this year because of our staff, but I want to leave you with one more. This year, the coaching staff decided to push practice time back 1 hour. On school days in prior years, football practice started at 3:15. This year, Coach Taglieri began at 4:15 so student athletes could attend study hall prior to participating in football. By doing this, he and his coaching staff, who did not cut their practice time down, made a tremendous sacrifice as they all arrived home to their families and loved ones 1 hour later every day. Now, last year, they won a state championship, so they clearly didn't have to do this. However, the coaches illuminated the importance of academics by actually having their students focus on school for an extra hour before turning their attention to football. In the term student-athlete, the word student comes before the word athlete. In Coach's football program, study hall came before practice. The point could not be any clearer, and I believe our student-athletes realized the personal sacrifices our coaches were making for them. The results have been staggering. In coming weeks, you will read about players making all-county and all-state. You may hear about the colleges recruiting some of our student-athletes and the commitments that they will eventually make and the scholarships they will eventually earn. However, I want to share some of the accomplishments our student athletes are making right now in the classroom and I think Daly Study Hall has something to do with it. Not one of our 40-plus varsity football members were declared academically ineligible after the first marking period. However, 10 of these athletes were named to the athletic director's list, high honors, or the honor roll. There was one senior invited to join the National Honor Society. Several members of our football team challenged themselves with AP courses and are getting excellent grades. And one football player has the highest combined PSAT score in the entire sophomore class. It's evident that sacrifice and hard work of the coaching staff and the student athletes have paid dividends. Through the efforts of our coaching staff, in combination with parents, the teachers here at Hoboken, and our administration, these are the type of student athletes we have here. Dedicated, responsible, accountable, willing to make sacrifices, and willing to delay gratification, respectful, and hardworking, and student athletes. Oh yeah, and by the way, they're one heck of a football team. So Dr. Toback and members of the board, I am extremely proud to present to you, once again, the 2013 NJSIA North 2 Group 1 State Champions. I don't want to hold you up too long. First of all, thank you for the honor. Okay, on behalf of the Red Wings, it's surreal. For what we went through, the adversity this team went through, and to come out on top, you can write books about this. Okay, and it takes a lot more. If we said we want the Red Wing team up here, all right, I would want the board up here. I'd want administration. All the faculty, because that's what it takes to put a quality team out on that field, okay? We didn't lose a player this year to academic ineligibility, okay? We lost players. We probably lost arguably two of our best players for the whole season, okay? And that adversity hit, we overcame that, okay? Two more players go down with injuries. One the week before the championship game, no problem with that. Okay, and I have to tell his story. Okay, we lost two players the week before the state championship. Okay, because of code of conduct violations. Okay, and that had to be the hardest decision for Ms. Picapetra and Ms. Gullo. Okay, but it was the right decision. All right, and people need to understand. We do things right here at Hoboken High School, okay? We don't make exceptions for anybody, okay? And if that didn't happen, okay, these players behind me or student athletes wouldn't have learned the lesson that they learned. I've coached for some great teams, all right? The number 10 team in the country, the number one team in the state of New Jersey, okay? But I don't think any of those teams had the heart and desire that this team behind me had. Okay? There was nothing was going to stop them. All right? I need to thank Dr. Toback and Dr. Hernandez for all their support. The whole board for the support. Without you guys, there is no Hoboken Red Wing football team. The administration at the high school, all the faculty at the high school, Mr. Callaghan and the custodial staff, I'm sure you're aware of that. We stood, the Office of Emergency Management gave us cots, and we stood at that field house the night before the game. The kids got up at 5 o'clock. It was spotless. The salvage was spotless. Kudos to Mr. Callaghan and all the custodial staff that did that. Now, I can't thank enough of people. It would take too long. Once again, thank you on behalf of the Hoboken Red Wings.
Thank you. Woo!
Follow me.
That flag. I love it.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Yeah, I got to hit them.
I feel like they're still under pads.
Careful, it's Rita.
Oh, look at this, my tree tag.
There it comes.
Congratulations. A little out of order, but does any board members want to say anything? Yes?
Yes.
Please.
I'd like to say that that was a great game, even though I really don't understand it that much. It was great to see them win at the last 15 seconds. That's all I have to say. Thanks, guys. It was great.
Very exciting.
Mr. Bell. Anybody? Please.
Yeah, just echoing Ms. Marco's sentiments, it was heart-stopping that last minute, and I'm glad that fumble was recovered, wherever you are, at the goal line there. Great job, my man, and congratulations. The only thing sweeter than winning a state championship is obviously winning it twice in a row, and I'm so proud of you guys, and I know we all are up here. Congratulations again.
Mr. Chair?
I'll go with it. For me, the words student-athlete are the two best words I could hear as the board president, so I want to thank you so much.
Mr. Chair?
Fran?
Yes. Congratulations again, and as they were coming down the line, I was asking Peter, what do they get for the state championship? Rings? Jackets? I think they should get everything. Approved by me.
No, sure. They last year they received. You see some of them wearing jackets. They also received these beautiful rings.
Great. Ruthie,
thank you, Mr. England, too, for explaining, and thank you to the faculty and the coaches for that study hour, because it's really a wonderful proof of what committed educators we have in this district, and well, to the men on the team, congratulations.
Dr. Toback?
Okay. We're going to go to the recognition part of the program, and then we're going to go to, then I'll do my report. Okay?
Okay.
So, Dr. Hernandez?
Thanks. Good evening, Mr. President and fellow board members. It's a pleasure this evening to recognize the Students of the Month at each of the schools. At Calabro School, we have a fourth grader, Sydney Wacha. Sydney is a wonderful young woman. She is caring, well-mannered, and respectful to all students and adults. Whenever you need help, Sydney is more than willing to volunteer. She always goes above and beyond in her schoolwork and doesn't settle unless it is her absolute best. Sydney is a great role model for her classmates and shows positive enthusiasm in helping others. She encourages students and everyone around her to be successful. Overall, Sydney's leadership, skills, dedication to her school and to her work and overall attitude for success are the reason she has been chosen as Collaborative School's November Student of the Month. Congratulations, Sydney. Our next student is from Connors Elementary School, a kindergarten student, Jada Rivera. Jada has been awarded. Jada has been awarded Student of the Month for many reasons. Jada is a student who exemplifies good manners and is a good example for her peers. Jada has achieved many goals put in place throughout our daily learning in kindergarten. Jada shows her understanding of the Connors mantra through daily practice and routine. Jada is a student who tries her best and works to achieve her goals. I am proud to give the title of Student of the Month to Jada Rivera. Our next student is a fourth grader from Wallace Elementary School, Mateo Mesnor. Mateo consistently shows excellent effort and exhibits mastery on all tests and quizzes across all subject areas. He is a nice, well-behaved student and gets along very well with others. Mateo also recently joined the Science Club due to his excellence and interest in the science curriculum. It is a pleasure to have him in class. Please join me in congratulating Mateo as a Student of the Month. Our next student of the month, this is a special one, first time in the history of the Hoboken Public Schools, our junior high school student of the month, seventh grader, Gianella Santiago. Gia is a very involved student. She puts her studies first and always goes the extra mile. Gia is an outgoing and charming student. Additionally, she has been very involved in school as well as district activities. Gia is an outstanding member of the Hoboken Junior High student body and a member of the Gifted and Talented program in the Hoboken Public Schools. Please join me in congratulating Gia Nala Santiago. Senior high school overall student of the month, 11th grader, also one of our football players, Danny Clifford. It's too big.
You should be reading that.
Yeah. Danny has shown a great love of media production, almost to match his love for football and being a Red Wing. Dan did an excellent job on his first video project, Pump Up Red Wings, a 3-minute highlight video of this year and last year's Red Wing football successes. Dan has also helped other student players create their highlight videos, which helps them submit their athletic abilities to the colleges of their choice. Dan has just completed his second video project, a brief tribute to breast cancer awareness. Dan has been an excellent member of the sports and television journalism class and has earned the title of associate producer in that class. Nice. Please join me in congratulating Dan Clifford as a student of the month. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Toback, your report. Okay. We'll give a few seconds. Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Congratulations, guys.
Also, if you wish to speak for agenda or public items, the sign-up sheet is where? It is up there. Okay. Okay. So can everybody hear?
So we're going to do superintendent's report, and then we have another presentation for the Board of Ed, okay?
Great.
Okay. So I'd like to take a moment to wish all of our students, staff, residents, and of course our board members a happy holiday season, and also my best wishes for a great new year. I have a variety of different things to report on, some by school, some by different events that have happened in the district. So I'd start with Hoboken Junior High School. Junior Senior High School is participating in the Hour of Code. About 200 students in grades 7 to 11 will take part in the Hour of Code as part of Computer Science Education Week, which is this week. About 40 seniors have volunteered to serve as tutors to assist with the project. The Hour of Code is a one-hour introduction to computer programming designed to demystify code and show that anyone can learn to be a computer programmer. Hour of Code modules and tools are self-directed. Students and teachers will be able to choose among a variety of one-hour tutorials to participate in the Hour of Code. Students from across the country, schools across the country, are participating in this activity. So it's a very exciting thing for our high school students. Also like to tell the board about our Hoboken Junior High electives. So I'm happy to report that our after-school activities for the junior high students are beginning to take shape a little better than what they were before. As it stands, we've started a new chapter of the National Junior Honor Society. And that's to recognize the achievements of our students and to also encourage scholarship, service, leadership, character, and citizenship. In addition, we have the Sierra Club, Fitness Club, and an Arts and Crafts Club, as well as participation in after-school activities such as the play, things like that. So there's a variety of great things going on for the students in the junior high program. On December 6th, seven students from Doug McCauley's media production class enjoyed a trip to his alma mater, School of Visual Arts in New York City. Purpose of the trip was for our students to see and get a feel of one of the top video schools on the East Coast and possibly the country. Our students had a chance to visit the various studios, editing rooms, and they had a chance to see high-end production equipment and check out the animation department. College and career readiness is a theme at all of our schools this year. And the Student Center at Hoboken Junior Senior High School is working very hard to help support the theme. They have been actively helping students get ready for careers and college opportunities after high school. In October, the Student Center picked up where the culinary arts class left off by taking a field trip to the Culinary Arts Institute at Hudson County Community College. In partnership with the guidance department, they also took students to visit the campus of Rider University and Seton Hall University. Students were provided with an overview of the admissions process, the Equal Opportunity Fund, the eligibility requirements, and the students also enjoyed a tour of the campuses. Hoboken Junior High School also has concluded their second Hunger Games competition, which created a lot of excitement at the high school. It's based on Catching Fire, which is the second novel in the trilogy by Suzanne Collins. School library media specialist and head game maker Michelle McGreevy wanted to use the film's release to inspire more students to read. On October 29th, the Connor School underwent a walkthrough from the Regional Achievement Center. Connor School is on track to end their designation as a focus school by the end of the school year. This is great news for the Connor School community and also for the district. So tomorrow, something very exciting is happening here at Wallace School. Principal Bowley is running a basketball clinic in camp. He's a former camp director for Boston Celtic coach Casey Jones. So he ran a basketball camp with Casey Jones for many years, and he has quite a background as a basketball player and coach. So he's running his very own basketball clinic here tomorrow for Wallace School students. So I look forward to hearing how that went. I'm sure he'll do a great job. Student council members at Wallace School had their meeting this week to organize two of their projects. They're selling candy grams during lunch and recess and also decorating a holiday tree. And the student council will accept donations for hats and gloves for those less fortunate. Mr. Bally continues to run his special friends luncheon, which has become a very popular thing here at Wallace. Students are able to invite two special friends to join them at lunch and recess. The comment from many of the parents who participate or the guests who participate is how wonderful school lunch is, and if only they can come every day. So that's a good thing. Students from Collaborative School, Connor School, and Wallace School participated in a program called Fight to Be Fit. It doesn't involve fighting. It is a program that was developed by Sue Wicks, who is a former WNBA player and Rutgers University All-American. Students participated in a four-week web-based competition designed to help students to learn about and make better decisions about eating and exercise. Principal Vespignani is very happy that the Collaborative School is the winner. They won the competition, and so very excited about that. And Mr. Vespignani is also can be seen doing, he's on video somewhere, involved in a push-up competition with one of his students. So that can be found if you Google it. The Collaborative School also has a nice partnership with Fairleigh Dickinson University. I'd like to report to the board. The director of the College of Education, Dr. Vicky Cohen, has been attending after-school meetings with the teachers to help them build strategies for struggling students, so build their reading skills, which is a very exciting thing. Many of the teachers have commented on what a positive experience that is, and so we certainly appreciate her help. It's at no cost to the district. Final Collaboro note, Ms. Asklar, Terhoon, and fifth grade students will be going to Liberty Science Center in one of the final sessions of their involvement for the One World Super Bowl program. The One World Super Bowl program is sponsored by the National Football League as a lead up to the Super Bowl that's being held here at MetLife Stadium. The program is a multicultural education program that brings together students from many walks of life in many communities. The Collaboro School fifth grade students were selected, and as a result, they've had pen pals from Brooklyn this year, and they will have a chance to meet their pen pals when they go to Liberty Science Center, in addition to lots of other NFL-sponsored activities. So that should be a very exciting thing. They've been participating in lots of different activities throughout the fall. As far as upcoming events go, on December 17th, we have Financial Aid Night at Hoboken Junior Senior High School. December 18th, we have the District Holiday Concert, also at Hoboken Junior Senior High School. Reminder to all district parents that there is a 1 o'clock dismissal for the next two Fridays, December 13th and December 20th. On January 28th, the Hoboken Board of Education will be hosting a community forum. Dr. Gold will be speaking about that in a little bit. Are you going to talk about that?
For a few minutes, yes.
Okay. And then I would also like to just take a few moments to recognize two of our board members that will no longer be serving on the board. Okay, so first of all, we have Carmelo Garcia. Carmelo obviously is not here tonight. He's been one of the longest-term board members that we have, serving what would have been 12 years at least on the Board of Ed. So his many years of dedication to the community, to the students, to the school district should be noted. And it would be nice to be able to say all this to him, but he's unable to be here tonight. But last but not least, I would like to take a moment to recognize the service of another longtime Board of Ed member. Now, she told me earlier that she did not want any recognition, and she's given me that look, which I know, and she's told me this many times. And she's also said to me many times, I know you don't want to hear it, but. So I'm going to reverse that a little today. I know you don't want to hear it, but wanted to say that I admire the work of Rosemary Markle during her many years of service to the Hoboken Public Schools as a board member. Service on any Board of Ed is not an easy thing, and it can be sometimes very difficult. What I appreciate is the fact that she's been a rock-solid source of support for the public schools in Hoboken. She has been a voice for the students and has always voted to support their academic needs. What I appreciate most of all is my work with her during her 2 years when she served as Board of Ed President when I first came on board to work here for the Hoboken Public Schools. So I won't drag this out much longer. I just want to say thank you, Rose, for your support and your unwavering support of the school system. Much appreciated. Now, the last part of my presentation, well, it's not my presentation, I'm going to hand things over. Now, I'm very happy to report that we have a speaker tonight at our board meeting to present a very positive program that is in use in Connor School. Dr. Blair Rosenthal from the New Jersey Department of Education is here to discuss the Positive Behavior Supports in School program, also known as PBSIS, that has been established at Connor School and has been in use since the start of the school year. Last year, the staff went through the training to prepare for the program. It is now in full use, and as I said, it started in the beginning of the year. So I'd like to introduce Dr. Rosenthal and also Mr. Fitzhugh, who may have a few words to say.
Good evening, board, Dr. Toback, parents, community. I have to say that the Connor School is moving towards Blue Ribbon certification. I say that all the time because of the work of the students and the staff. And as this evening, when you see the work of the staff here at the Connor School, they created the work that will catapult the school towards fine excellence. The PBSIS program establishes common practices throughout our building and allows the students to become true works of art, not only pedagogically, but also socially within our building. Instances have gone down tremendously. There's a focus on the academics, focus on the academics. And again, with the students being in the forefront of the mission and vision of this work, you will see the great work that the students put forth, the staff put forth, in creating a climate of change towards the Connor School, school year 13-14. Dr. Rosenthal.
Good evening, Dr. Toback and the board. Thank you for having me. My name is Dr. Blair Rosenthal. I'm going to introduce myself and our initiative, give you a little bit of highlighted background as to why we're doing the good things that we're doing at Connor School, and then showcase what the staff and students have been doing to contribute to a positive school year. So the goal of tonight is just to orient you to positive behavior support in schools, the state initiative, and overview what the multi-level intervention is that's going on right now at the school. I apologize to the board to have to turn around.
I'm gonna go sit in the audience.
Go right ahead, make yourself comfortable. Good. So I am part of a collaboration with the New Jersey Department of Education, Office of Special Education. I'm actually housed through Rutgers, Robert Wood Johnson. I'm part of a larger state training team under our director, Dr. Sharon Lorman, and we work with our Department of Ed liaison, Perky Cannon, who is out to see Mr. Fitzhugh and Ms. Latman and within the recent weeks to see all the good things that Connors was doing. The purpose of our initiative sort of has four components. We're looking at increasing available instructional time, and what we're trying to do is orient the students towards more positive, productive behaviors. And by doing this, this allows the teachers to focus their energies on teaching rather than having to redirect students when they're off task or engaging in inappropriate behavior. It also teaches the students what pro-social, productive behaviors we want them to be doing so that not only are they going to be successful students, but when they get out into the community, they're also going to be successful contributors to the Hoboken community and thereafter. We use a continuum of supports for students that are at risk. You often hear that these students are worked with the INRS teams and also the child study teams. And so the last piece to this is making sure that our environments are conducive to supporting students who have disabilities. The goal of the initiative as a whole is to make sure that we're doing something called promoting school connectedness, having students feel a value as to why they're going to school, for their education, but also to support their social and emotional needs. We're looking at reducing the number of students that are referred to special education by means of having behavioral issues, students that are repeatedly referred to the office, and are repeatedly suspended. And so we're looking at different ways to try to address those students' needs to have them be more successful. So you'll see the logo, Connors Cares. It's going to repeat over, and I have a handout for everyone on the board to take away. Just in terms of the general research as a whole, substantial research suggests that the top three predictors of students' academic and behavioral success all go on within the school day. So it's not to say that their life factors that they deal with are not influential, but the most influential things all go on throughout the day, and they all revolve around relationships with the staff and students. So I'm not going to read over the research bullets, but I just wanted you to be aware there's a substantial amount of literature out there that supports the need for students to have positive relationships with their teachers. And I'm sure we're all aware of this, and the research just solidifies that. It's really important to recognize that students' perceptions of relationships with teachers tends to become more negative as they get older. So it's even more critical as students get older to make sure we're fostering these positive relationships throughout their school day. Any other factor that students are dealing with can have the potential to be directed in the right way if the students are perceiving that they have support from their teachers and staff. So what the team was tasked to do, and I'm going to highlight the staff in Connor's building over the last 2 years and what they've been doing, was to tackle how to create a positive school climate and how to create school connectedness throughout the school day. And so these were a lot of the different pieces to the puzzle that I'll highlight that they went through in training last year, like Dr. Toback mentioned, and then in implementation this year. We're a three-tiered model. We operate very similar to the RTI type model. This is a national model. I'll give some stats on that in a minute. The bottom line is that we're shifting how we intervene with students from reactive to proactive at whatever extent we can possible. Positive behavior support is a national model. It's about 18, 20,000 schools. There's 44 states around the country. Connor School is the first school in Hoboken that has worked with the state's initiative. And currently, the Department of Ed has directed our efforts towards working with only priority and focus schools. And so the RAC director put a request in for Connors to work with us, and they've done some fantastic stuff. So this is the multi-level model. Last year we planned and trained the green part, we call that the universal intervention, meaning whatever we're providing is accessible to all staff, all students, regardless of level of need. We also trained the child study team, which is the top tier, the students that have the most need. And we just finished training the INRS folks in the middle for students who are showing at-risk type behaviors. The purpose of the universal intervention is to do three things. We want to encourage and solidify consistency throughout our day across the staff and students. We want everyone to be collaborative in terms of getting feedback, so the staff and students both gave feedback. And we're making data based on decision. When we see patterns in what the referral process is in our building, we're making decisions based on that, not just arbitrarily in terms of what we think the students need, but what the data in the building is telling us that our students actually do need. So these are the different pieces that the team planned, and I'm going to show you in actuality what they look like in Connor's building. But there were six main components. The building went through a self-assessment last year with surveys and walkthroughs. The building as a whole defined clear expectations throughout the building. I'll show you those in a minute. Created a school-wide recognition system where any student could get recognized when they're engaging in appropriate behaviors. Created a way to teach the students what these expectations look like with a lot of help from Hoboken High School's video department. So we thank them. We're going to show off what they did in a minute. Revising what our office conduct referral process looks like and making decisions based on data. So they've had a big task to do, but they've done it well. So this represents what we call the universal team. Mrs. Latman is the coach. She's leading it. She's here tonight, along with the administrators, as well as several other staff members that represent the voice at large. We definitely got staff input across the board. These folks were the planners and the final decision makers. The team came up with a motto. This is hung in banners around the building. It's on lots of documents. We call it our overarching expectations. So wherever you go in the school, you can ask the kids. They know that we say Connors cares, and the C stands for cares. We commit to learning. A, act responsibly. R, respect everyone. E, effort matters. And S, soar to success. So the kids embody that throughout their day. So there's an example of the banner when you walk in the school. It's hanging. If you haven't been there recently, check it out on your next visit. We've operationally defined what it is that we look for students to do all across the building. So it's a little hard to see with the lighting, but there's two arrows pointing to posters that are hanging in the top of the cafeteria, and there's cafeteria expectations in terms of what is appropriate. I apologize, the lighting isn't so good for that. There's a recess poster on the back door when the students go out to playground, prompting them what the expectations are. And this allows the staff to have a common language. And when we have a student, whether you know the student or not, and they may be not acting the way we want them to be, the posters serve as an easy tool to remind the students, what does Connor's Cares behavior look like? And so this helps the students to stay on track. We explicitly taught the students what this actually looks like. So I'm gonna give a little kudos to the high school team and show you, hopefully my technology cooperates, just a little snippet of what they created. And this is how we taught our students. I'm just gonna skip over. So that just kind of gives you a snippet, and we had it for all locations of the building, so thank you to the high school team. They made our lives much, much easier. So we just wanted to give you a preview. So the administrators collaborated and coordinated a schedule. We walked the students around to all locations of the building with the expectations, and we also set up opportunities for them to see them in action and see peers that I believe were in fifth and sixth grade last year, right? Fifth grade last year, so they would still be in the school this year so that they could see their friends. So we taught the students what they look like, and then we created a plan for how we recognize the students and celebrate the students and staff's contribution to the school. So you may have heard about this. If not, this is the Connor's Wheel. So what happens is you'll see bins at the bottom that are shown there. Students drop tickets off when they get recognized from any staff member in the building, custodial worker, security, drop them in the bin. They're labeled by grade. Every Friday, lunch has a whole new meaning now because the kids who get picked out, they do a drawing, they get to spin the wheel, the kids cheer for each other. It's a lot of good community building. It's very positive. They have a lot of fun and they celebrate each other. And even if they don't win, they learn to celebrate their peers that are winning. So the cafeteria now has a very different tone in a positive direction. We've also taken on some school-wide celebrations. So during the Week of Respect, every day was a different part of the motto. So what you're seeing here, if you haven't been to Connor's recently, this is the Wave of Respect. So the kids designed hands. It's hanging all throughout when you walk in the building, up and down the staircase, around the post. The kids decided that they were going to commit to using their hands for respect. And so it's a really neat way to pull everybody together. Having a school-wide recognition system does align with New Jersey's administrative code. So for anyone who has concerns or questions about that, it does fall in line with the code. And now what we're doing is getting the staff on board with helping to collect data on identifying what patterns we see that are going out through the building. What locations are the students still having difficulty in where we need to either reteach the expectations, check the flow of traffic, make sure we don't have too many kids passing at the hall at the same time. What infractions are we seeing? If we're seeing pockets of students in similar infractions, what are we doing to address that? So really comprehensive and thorough. The blue bar is last year, the red bar is this year. So for the most part, we're seeing drops so far. We also know that when we start this program, folks tend to be more attentive in terms of writing discipline referrals. So seeing some increases is definitely not something that's of a concern, but we make ongoing decisions and we revisit it. I also think the kids are having more fun in the cafeteria now. We're also looking at across the school day when we're seeing spikes so we can plan accordingly. Certainly, we could speculate that period 9 means it's time to go home. So we want to make sure that we're planning around how do we make the students be successful, but we can't do that unless we have the data to make those decisions. Like I mentioned, we train the INRS team as well to start to identify students with repeated behavior issues and really understand the function of their behavior. So this represents the INRS team who are now going to be spearheading this additional process to build capacity across the school to work with students with repeated behavior issues. So I just wanted to highlight them. On average, 80% of the kids will respond to the universal intervention, which is what I showed you around the ticket system, the wheel. But we'll still have a pocket of students that'll need more, and that's why the INRS team folks are trained to address those types of needs. And like I said, they just finished training with me last week. For those students who need more support, we've trained the staff on doing something called mapping out behavior and understanding what we call function of behavior. What it means is in terms of what the benefit is to the student to engage in that problematic behavior and be more clear about how do we plan around them to be more successful. So that's a parallel training to what Child Study Team got last year. So they're doing the same types of supports. And we have this individualized level of need for students who are already classified. So the Child Study Team members were trained on that as well. So we've got a really comprehensive effort across wherever the students fall in terms of their continuum of need. So this targets about 5% of the students, the ones who already have IEPs, and those students are protected under procedural safeguards through special education, but we have a process in place for them now as well. So like I said, it's a multi-tiered intervention. So now we have all three supports in place. We have a lot of redundancy across team members, so that allows each tier of intervention to know what the other tier is doing. Next steps. So what are we looking for? Schools that implement this with fidelity in the first year report anywhere between a 15 to 40% reduction in office conduct referrals as well as suspensions. And we know that students that get suspended, it's a predictor of more suspensions, and we want to find alternate ways to keep them in school if we can at all possible. We're also looking at improvements in the climate and general competence in terms of using more effective interventions tailored to meet students' needs, especially when they're around behavior. So these are the outcomes that we're seeing right now, and I'm sure Mr. Fitzhugh could solidify that we're seeing that across the school day. If you haven't been in Connors recently and you had been there in years past, the one thing I will tell you is I've been there several times this year. The hallways are very quiet. So you're starting to see that students know that there are a certain time and place for their socialization, and the hallway is not one of them. So where are we going with this? The team has just finalized some updated forms in regards to the office conduct referral process. We're continuing with our drawings. We're continuing with professional development. One of the benefits we're seeing is we have to build the staff's capacity around what these students need in order for them to be successful. We want to continue to start to think about what are our options for fundraising, talking with students about what incentives they're motivated to have. Sometimes they cost nothing and they're privileges for the school day. Sometimes they cost something small. So we want to think about what our options are. And then how do we then share our knowledge with other schools in the district? Because certainly there's a benefit. So that's all she wrote for me. I have handouts for the board. If anyone has any questions, I'll happily entertain them. Mr. Fitzhugh, if you want to say anything else.
Thank you. I'd just like to thank the Connors Elementary School staff, from the students to the teachers to the non-instructional to the support staff to the board for your support, as well as from our district administration. Without all those entities together, again, we cannot believe we will not achieve. Again, I thank you for your time and attention this evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Toback. Okay, we'll have the finance report now. BA report.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, I'd like to give an update in regard to the Board of Education vacancy. We had advertised in the local newspapers and have posted an ad on the district website soliciting candidates for our anticipated vacancy. Quickly, a resume and or one-page cover letters are due in my office by the close of business on Monday, December 16th. Anybody that would like further details, if you'd like to visit our website, it's on the homepage. Second is the audit update. The external audit team is gone. They're finished and in the process of producing the reports, and we await the physical documents to be delivered to our offices. Once we receive it, which we anticipate on the next few business days, we'll be delivering them to the board when we receive them. Lastly, the grant from the Hurricane Sandy New Jersey Relief Fund. Phase one is underway. The district network assessment has started, and the first project has been identified. It's focused on the Connor School. We are currently in the process of soliciting prices for that repair and upgrade. I also made contact with the staff in the relief fund to discuss appropriate documentation in regard to the item you'll see tonight, 12.02, which is the grant modification, just to discuss any required documents that we need to submit. We did discuss the fact that it would be on our books, per se. It would be something responsible, that we were responsible to accumulate and document appropriately. So that would include evidence of cost and expenditure to be submitted, and it would be consistent with our other financial regulations as a public school, and would be subject to our own internal audit. So I want to make sure we have all that documented appropriately, and I'll work to that end in the event that you see fit to approve that tonight. And that concludes my.
We're going now. Our Finance Committee report.
Thank you, Leanne. Finance Committee meeting was held last Wednesday, December 4th, from 8:30 until approximately 10 a.m. Joining me were Peter Biancomano, Leon Gold, Irene Sobolov, Dr. Toback, and our Business Administrator Bill Moffitt. We don't have a large agenda of finance items, nothing extraordinary, and we did review all of them, and we do recommend all to the board for approval. Mr. Moffitt just reviewed some of the other things that we discussed at the meeting. Talked a little bit about the budget planning is in the preliminary stages. I mean, there's nothing to report yet, but there's a presentation that will be made at the community meeting that Leon, you'll talk about in a minute, in January. You did mention that I know we'd like to talk about legal fees here, and that legal fees continue to be monitored. And Mr. Moffitt reported that sort of we're, according to the most recent invoice we received, we're on target to stay within our goal. And there was no update on food services this month. I think November Thanksgiving fell very late in the month, and the Finance Committee meeting happened sort of immediately after the end of the month. You hadn't received information yet, but that will be forthcoming. And as is my habit, we want to acknowledge two donations. These are specifically for the class of 2014, which I know Mr. Munoz and Lorna Martinez are here, who are the class, she's back there, the class advisors, and we're doing a tremendous job in raising money for the class of 2014. Tonight we want to acknowledge two contributions, $100 from freeholder Anthony Romano and $500 from the Jersey City Medical Center. Thank you.
All right.
I'm done.
That's it. Okay, governance.
Governance Committee met Wednesday, December 4th. In attendance was Dr. Toback, Mr. Gagliardi, Leon Gold, Irene Sobolov, Ruth McAllister, and Rosemary Markle. All items on the agenda were discussed. Nothing unusual, but I would like to wish, we have one retirement, I'd like to wish Ms. Bill Fiore all the best in her retirement in the future.
Okay, curriculum.
Curriculum Programs Committee met on Tuesday, December 3rd, from 5:30 to 7. Myself, Leon Gold, and Jean Marie Mitchell were in attendance, as well as Ms. Bachknight and one member of the public. We discussed the two course approvals that are on the agenda, AP U.S. Government and Politics and High School Ceramics. We talked about Ms. Bachknight is beginning the evaluation of various pre-K programs that will better address the diversity and the starting points of our pre-K population, as well as lead better into the Common Core curriculum, which begins in kindergarten. We discussed the high school music program and our desire to see the program as credited classes in the high school. We talked about homework and classroom strategies, including homework for the elementary students, the reverse lecture methodology that's been recently in the press, and portfolio building for elementary and middle schoolers. On the agenda is a new pilot social studies series for kindergarten. I apologize, board, I wrote first grade in the report, for kindergarten. And we also had an update on the student growth objectives, which our teachers are working diligently on. Our next meeting tentatively is Tuesday, January 14th at 5:30 p.m. I say tentatively because it's out of our regular schedule, but Ms. Bocknight is nodding at me, so it's definitely Tuesday, January 14th at 5:30 in the board conference room. And public, please remember you're welcome to attend.
Okay, thank you. Athletics?
The Athletic and Performing Arts Committee met on December 4th. In attendance was Mr. Hernandez, myself, and Rose Markle. In the athletics area, we discussed the upcoming football game, which now we all know how that went, so that was a very, very cold but exciting game. Nice for them. Student participation in various sports was discussed, and also what you heard a little bit about was the athletic director's academic list, which we discussed that a little bit, which is a nice thing. Student athletes who complete the season while maintaining the 89 average are honored and acknowledged at the school. And it's been increasing. It's in its second year, so it's been increasing. The drama department had arranged for two professionally led workshops at Hoboken High School, and one was completed on December 4th. The second one regarding monologues will take place on December 20th. The drama department will hold one of its fundraising events, which is a holiday caroling event at ShopRite on December 14th. So I'm not sure about the time, but I think it might be on the website, so we can get back to you on that. So if you're around ShopRite, that'll be a nice thing.
Okay, great. Facilities.
Hi there. The facilities committee met on December 4th at 4:15. In attendance was myself as chair, Leon Gold, the board president, Tim Callagy, the facilities director, John Peprota, the food services, Sodexo food services manager, and Brian Beeney, the district chef. at the Brandt School, in January, there's a funding in the capital program to upgrade 5 more bathrooms at Brandt. There'll be, after those are finished, that'll be 90% of the bathrooms would be upgraded in that building. We're all tired of the scaffolding at Brandt School. We're expecting a letter from the SDA in mid-January of a notice to proceed. We cannot take the scaffolding down. In the meantime, the state will close down the school. The district is fronting the cost of the scaffolding, but it'll be reimbursable reimbursable from July 1st, 2012. The food services, John Peprota from Sodexo reported that sales of meals are continuing to increase. We're in the second year of the Sodexo 3-year food services contract, and I'm happy to report that the district has emerged from a $1 million deficit in the food services budget to now we're in the black. October 2013 was our most active month this school year, and we attained a count of 22,497 lunches served. That's 2,325 more lunches than last October, than the previous year. Also in October, our breakfasts served have increased to 13,602 served, and that's 4,183 more breakfasts than last year. The count is slightly down in November because of the holiday. However, the count is still higher than last year. As I state nearly every public board meeting, is that the elementary and junior senior high school, the breakfasts are free to all students, whether they are qualified for free and reduced lunch. So it's free breakfast for those children. Sodexo is also preparing to sponsor a health fair to encourage a community outreach. And the fair will be scheduled in February or March, and it'll be scheduled in cooperation with the phys ed department. At the junior senior high school, the lockers on the second floor are coming to the end of their useful life and should be replaced. They should be installed over the summer and be ready for school in September. There's also kind of an abused area by the JFK field There's a shady alcove in front of the JFK field wall where the Veterans Memorial is, and that area is really frequented by people walking their dogs and fouling up the area, and that will be fenced in the near future. So that's my report. Thank you.
Thank you very much. A few words from the board. First of all, this will be our last meeting of this year, so I'd like to wish all of you a safe and happy new year and holiday, and we'll see you in a few weeks, but we have a lot more of the meeting to go. I'd like to, again, thank the football team. Their academic and athletic success is truly uplifting. I want to thank the coaches, the administrators, the teachers, the staff. It's a group effort, and the speech that we heard from our athletic director was absolutely uplifting, and to see all the students walk by and shake their hand, and it's moving. It makes it worth being a board member, and sometimes you need that, so that was pretty nice. I would like to invite you to go to the BOE website, and when you go to it, you're going to see a link that says Community Budget Forum. On January 28th, I would have called it Mythbusters, but the official name is Community Budget Forum. We're going to have a meeting that describes the budget process. And it describes the budget process from our funds that are coming in and how we spend them, where the money gets allocated. It's going to be a very, very important meeting. I'll be a little presumptuous and say that if you don't go to this meeting, you don't have a right to have an opinion. So I'm going to invite our elected officials. I'm going to invite our community leaders. I'm going to invite the administrators of our various school districts to show up for this. You've been given 7 weeks' notice, and no one ever accused me of being subtle. So the date is Tuesday, January 28th, and please put that in your calendar. The write-up is really good. Please go to the website and look at it. What is so good about it is that we have a website, or I guess an email address, which is budgetquestions@hoboken.k12.newjersey.us, and we will take all your questions and comments, and they will be integrated into the presentation.
Mr. Chair?
I'm not finished.
I don't know if it was going to be televised.
Excuse me?
Is it going to be televised also?
I don't know yet.
Okay.
For Mr. Carmelo and Ms. Rosemarie Markle.
Carmelo Garcia.
Mr. Carmelo Garcia.
Thank
I
you.
Apologize. And Ms. Rosemarie Markle, this will be their last board meeting as board members. Believe me, I know how difficult a job it is to be a board member. And on behalf of the board, I would like to thank them for their service to our school and our community. I'm done. So if anybody has some questions before we have people from the agenda come up and speak.
This is on the, go ahead, Mr. Garcia.
I'm sorry, Mr. Bianco. And Mr. President, you know I'm gonna have some questions, but more importantly, just wanna acknowledge my reason for my delay in attending tonight. I had a wake prior to, we had one of our former captains who passed away. So he's a friend of the family. In any event, with that said, I just wanted to, I heard that there was some kind words said by the superintendent and now yourself. It's been 11 years on this board, and it was interesting to, for me to see on NG.com this story about, you know, me resigning, and I had not submitted my official resignation yet. So I had unfinished business and planned to attend tonight's meeting, as well as until I get sworn in, will I be submitting my official resignation, Mr. President and superintendent and board secretary. Because I did read the story in NJ.com, and I contacted Katie and I said, where'd this come from? I didn't submit my official resignation yet because it made it seem like I had resigned already and everybody was calling me up. Did you resign? Did you resign? I said, listen, I'm tied to my responsibility and to my constituents, so I will be here till the last day that I can serve this community as a school board member, because it's been a great honor in almost 12 years being on this board and having the great, great discourse that we've had, but the milestones have been tremendous. And I think that we will leave you in the hands of a great direction moving forward. And my only encouragement to this board is that, as I am the only Latino minority on this board, that hopefully you take into consideration mirroring what the diversification in the community is by appointing someone on this board who would really represent the community in its entirety, particularly someone of a minority background who just has that cultural background and difference to represent the community. With that said, Mr. Chairman, so I want that to be clear that I still have not submitted my official resignation. Until I do so, I am still serving this board as a school board member. I have had the great fortune of being in contact with the DOE as a assemblyman-elect and speaking to Commissioner Scherf, which has been an amazing experience, and we will talk about that, you know, later on. But in the interim, I want to congratulate the Hoboken Red Wings, the football team, who did an amazing job, and most of those students are from the Housing Authority, which I take great pride in interacting with students like Josh Mercado and Danny Clifford and a few of them that are just amazing, amazing students. On top of that, I just wanted to acknowledge someone who was given an award by the Puerto Rican Culture Committee, Chris Munoz, in November. He was recognized by the Puerto Rican Culture. Stand up, Chris. Stand up. I will embarrass him. I will definitely embarrass him because, you know what, you do an outstanding job with the Hispanic Culture Club, and as a Latino teacher, you do an amazing, amazing job to inspire our students and all the teachers. I mean, there's a lot of great teachers who I've had the good fortune in 12 years to really develop a phenomenal relationship with and be a part of the progress and the great success that this district has had. Mr. Chairman, from the Finance Committee report, what I would ask is that if we can put up kind of the balance sheet and then just the budget to actuals so that when people come to the meeting on January 28th, they have the information necessary to ask the relevant questions on the school budget allocations, as well as that, because I know the superintendent wrote a wonderful letter that basically delineated exactly how does it work with how the money follows the child and how the budget basically split up into the 648 students for the charter schools, as well as they get funded through what we receive from the state. But I would only ask that those additional documents be put up on our website so that folks can just digest what it is that makes up the anatomy of a budget for a school district. And what that entails is a balance sheet, a budget to actual, the human resources, personnel, salary guide, or salaries as far as how that works with benefits and wages, so that folks can see by school how that budget is allocated and how does that in effect work, because the mechanics of it, in order for them to digest it and come with proper questions, they need to have all of that relevant information. With respect to facilities, I just wanted to ask, hopefully the facade, collaborative school, we've talked about changing the sign for collaborative school. Hopefully that will be happening. I know that there was a promise to have that take place. It hasn't yet, and hopefully we can do that on the facade of the collaborative school and that sign that's kind of like wasted and dilapidated, and if we can just kind of just spruce that up. And we talked about that many months ago. Actually, I think Fran, you and I had talked about that. So I'm hoping that will happen along with the locker rooms and stuff like that that we've been talking about. But just my point at this juncture
is
that—
I have an email. You can contact me. I'm the facilities chair.
Well, I'm sharing it now. It's
Thank
not for
you.
Me to contact
okay.
you.
Okay,
I'm just sharing it now because as the assemblyman, what I do intend to be is a tool or vehicle for this board, and I can promise you that I will be with the utmost advocacy ensuring that this district gets the resources that it needs from the state, especially after that presentation from the teacher and Mr. Fitzhugh, the principal there, commendable in what they're doing there, and Superintendent Toback, that is unbelievable as to the things that we've talked about that now have come to fruition, and the Connor School still to this day from an SDA perspective, which is the School Development Authority, does need, you know, I believe, a complete refurbishment to that institution, to that school facility. But I am so thrilled and commending the teachers at Connor School, the administration at Connor School, and this administration for what we're trying to do in universally bringing all schools up at the same time, because, you know, Wallace has always been the flagship. Hopefully Calabro and Connors can have that universal equality that they deserve, and that's happening. So that's just my take on it. I am committed to this district. I am committed to what we will do, and the board can count on me, the superintendent can count on me when I am sworn in to fight for the children of this district, to continue improving student achievement. I am proud of the milestones that we have had. I'm happy to see that even with the recent debate on the public school, charter school issue, that there is a merger and a bridge of some sort that we're building. I saw the mayor's letter, which was interesting and great to see that the mayor was, you know, issuing a letter in support of that charter school. But more importantly, to my colleague and to all my colleagues, you know, I love the fact that you're still committed. I love you guys, and I love the students, and I love the teachers. Thank you, and God bless you for all the work that you do for this district. I love you forever, and always a Red Wing. That's what I love the most. Thank you.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah. Yes?
I just wanted to address Carmelo about that I'm the legislative delegate for the NJSBA, so I'm going to be looking forward to working with you now as our assemblyman.
No, I'm just teasing you. So. I'm looking forward to that.
As if 11 years wasn't enough, huh, Carmelo?
Thank you, Peter.
Mr. Chair, I have some questions regarding the committee report.
Sure.
Thank you so much. Regarding the scaffolding at Brand School, what does a notice to proceed, what does that entail? Does that mean that the SDA is going to come in now and finally give us the funding we need to fix the facade at Brand School?
What it means is that now that we have permission, when they do pay the money, we're going to be paid from the date of the notice to proceed.
So they're going to provide the funding we need to fix
the facade? They're going to give us, I mean, unfortunately,
I'm
we
sorry,
have
I'm
to eat some
confused.
Of it, but.
I'm sorry?
Once we get the notice to proceed, mm-hmm. which we have, from that date is the date we get our funding. So we got the notice, so we're going to get paid from that date. If I'm incorrect, somebody.
And then with that funding, we're going to fix the facade at.
And pay for the scaffolding.
And pay for the scaffolding.
Yes.
And we're paying for the scaffolding from the day of the notice or from when the scaffolding was put up?
You were in finance meetings. Unfortunately,
well, we didn't talk about this.
Unfortunately,
in finance meetings. Sorry, go ahead.
We're paying for the scaffolding because somebody has to pay for it. So we are paying for the scaffolding. We will be reimbursed for most of it, but that is at the whim of the state. That is certainly not under our control at all.
Okay. And then regarding the meeting on the 28th, regarding the budget, I was just curious. You said that there's an email set up now where people can.
If you go to the Hoboken BOE
right.
website.
Can I ask my question before?
Okay.
Thank you. There's an email set up so people can submit questions for the budget. I was just curious, who receives those emails?
I believe Dr. Toback does.
Dr. Toback does. Okay. And then finally, on the I was just wondering, is this going to be formatted as a regular board meeting, or is it going to be more of a workshop?
It's going to be a town hall meeting. It'll be a presentation.
I see. Okay. Thank you.
The Q&A will be the submitted questions that you ask. It will be a presentation. We are going to have a communications group, and we will get ideas what is the best way to present it. It's really not a debate. It's really a town hall where we can communicate what we feel is the facts.
And residents will have the ability to ask questions that meeting, or they have to submit
we don't
it
know yet. Right now, if you have a question, please do the courtesy of submitting it on email or submitting it to a board member, and I'm sure they will get it to the superintendent.
And Mr. Chair?
Yes.
How come we don't know if it's going to be televised?
Because we haven't figured it out yet.
We have the means. We have our media.
This is something
here.
We could refer to a committee, please.
Okay, refer it to the committee. What committee should we refer it to?
Communication? Finance.
I don't know. Arts?
No.
Performing arts?
I'll put it in governance.
Since we use, yeah.
Governance will determine whether or not it will be televised.
Mr. Chair, just...
Finance?
Mr. Chair, excuse me.
Because it would be nice to have it televised for those people who cannot come to that meeting.
I agree with you, but I'm not going to come to a decision now. We'll bring it to either the Finance or Governance Committee, and we'll decide what resources we need to televise it. I have every assumption that it will be televised.
When will we know? When can you let us know on the website that it will be televised? Once your committee meets and decides whether it will be or won't be televised?
Dr. Toback, I'm at a loss.
May I just interject? There's two board meetings in January. So the Governance Committee meeting would be in the week of the 13th, I believe. Is that
it's the 7th and the 21st.
Okay. Are the meetings, so the governance meeting would be the 14th. So that would be the governance meeting to decide. And then okay. You can post it up right away, right?
My inclination is that it will be televised. Everything we do is televised. It's just that we haven't come to a decision as a board yet, so it wouldn't have been fair to say whether or not it will be.
Mr. Chair, just a couple of things. And that will be at the high school auditorium, correct?
I assume it will be. It might be at high school or Demarest?
High school.
I'll be at the high school.
School. Okay, just want to announce that as well. And is it possible to Ustream that as well? If we're considering just a bit videotaping it, maybe Ustreaming it might be a solution as well.
That might be a good idea. I'll submit all of them. I have no problem with that.
Thank you, Mr.
The most people who see it, the better.
I agree. Yeah.
We agree on that. Okay. Any other things before we talk public comment? Please.
Are we doing all committee comments now? Or?
Right, we're doing committee comments.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. For the budget meeting, is the link to last year's budget diagram still on the web?
All that's still available. The budget, okay. The user-friendly budget, information about the budget is available on the website already.
And it's in that feed in the center, correct? If we can lift that up, that might be nice. You know how things go down? I just think that was a really great piece of literature. It's actually talking about what Mr. Garcia was talking about, that where different things are. And I think it's a great starting point for people to think of questions. So if we could make that go up closer or have that attached in the announcement, I think that would be good. And we do have the two meetings in January to re-announce and reinforce. And I thank you, Ms. Mitchell, for the update on the scaffolding. I appreciate that. And I just wanted to say, Carmelo, thank you for your service. It's been a pleasure. And Rose, in the words of Eleanor Roosevelt, women are like tea bags. You do not know their strength until you put them in hot water. And Rose, you are one strong woman. And I just have to say that I'm a little scared thinking about you, Rosemary Markle, taking a seat in the audience and expressing your opinions at the podium. However, I'm less scared for me than I am for some others. So, Rosemary, I'm going to miss you, and I thank you for your service.
Thank you.
And Rosemary, if we're talking about water, still water runs deep, and you're really deep. So, thank you. If it wasn't for you, I wouldn't be here, so that's more reason for people to be upset with you. But it's been great. Thank you.
It's been fun.
May I address Rose?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. To Carmelo, happy trails. To Rose, I want to thank you for your years of passionate leadership and involvement. You possess keen insight, fairness, understanding, and a thick skin, crucial qualities for an effective board member. Thank you for all you've done for the Hoboken School District, and I wish you the very best. I especially look forward to your continued involvement and wisdom off the dais and behind the podium. I hope we can continue to sit together in the stands and cheer on the Hoboken Red Wings. Thank you so much for your service.
Mm-hmm. I didn't even know what to say. So I remembered meeting you in the audience with me as an interested parent, and then I was incredibly honored to run with you in 2010 and work side by side in I think almost every committee I could think of. We were always in there together. And I don't think I've ever met anyone so fiercely, fiercely committed to the students of the district. I mean, it was just the single only one priority, no matter what was going on in Hoboken or in your personal life. You came, no matter what, to every committee meeting, every board meeting. You were just working tirelessly to either serve the students of Hoboken or celebrate the students of Hoboken. And I've learned so much from you, Rose. I'm going to miss your wisdom, your historical knowledge, your advice, your incredible generosity, and certainly your sense of humor. So I wanted to thank you for everything.
Thank you.
Any other comments? We'll have the public portion out with the agenda. Please call the first person.
Would you like me to certify the election results? May I?
You have the okay, please.
Okay. I'd like to report that the clerk of Hudson County certified the November 2013 election results with 41,094 registered voters and 15,068 ballots cast. The winning candidates are Jennifer Evans, Leon Gold, Irene Soboloff. As board secretary, I will record this certification in the minute meeting. That was backwards. It's a meeting minutes. Thank you.
Okay.
And congratulations to Jennifer Evans, who's in the audience.
Jennifer.
And to you guys.
All right. I think we're ready for the public comments on the agenda. First person.
All right. I have three, I should say seven total. First one is Jennifer Evans.
Jennifer Evans, 1106 Park Avenue. I'm a parent of two children enrolled in the district schools, and I'm proud to send my children to the district schools, and I'm very happy with the education they are receiving. However, as a parent, I am concerned about the loss of funding that will necessarily occur if the expansion of OLA is approved. It does concern me that there are board members who were elected to represent the children of the district at the last meeting did seek to block Dr. Toback from sending his letter to the Department of Education. This would leave the state with no statement from the district about the impact of this expansion on the district schools and the students. I have to assume that those members will not support tonight's resolution. I would like to ask them to explain to the community and to the district parents how they plan to deal with this loss of funding. It seems to me that really there are only two options: a tax increase or a cost savings through reduction in programs or services to the district students. I would ask those members who do not plan to support the resolution to answer which of those they would propose, and if they are proposing cost cutting, I would like them to answer specifically what programs or services they would cut for the district students. Thank you.
Okay. Next person.
Patricia Waiters.
Good evening, board members. Patricia Waiters, 1233 Park Avenue. If you want to follow me, we're on the agenda, the second page of the agenda, presenting the legal votes cast on November the 5th. Tonight I'll stand here and say congratulations with only the hope that the elected members be trustees of the board, and we hope we can trust in your faith and allegiance to serve our school community. Oh, and thank you for the adjustment. I said I had 2021, it's 2063. So if that's confirmed with the Hudson County, I'll take it. Approval of policy revision for the principals. I've seen Bart Raleigh at Wallace, and you can answer me later because I want to use my whole 5 minutes. And this evaluation with principals coming in, I think this is a wonderful idea. I don't know the particulars, but just seeing him observe the classrooms, the look on those students' faces, and myself felt like I hit the Mega Million. This is exactly what I was talking about the students that live here to see the principals that they had in the past that they dealt with to come back into the school district is excellent. Now on the letter, on pages is not clarified here. Well, anyway, resolution 9.16, approval of superintendents. Is this the letter, the actual letter that was sent out? I see the letter when you read further from Dr. Toback. Whereas October 15, 2013, the whole our school, all right, but the letter is to follow. All right, with that being said, I was at the last meeting, and unfortunately, it appeared to be political because it was right after the election, but I took time and I watched the meeting 15 times back to back to back every day. And I did a little research, and it was mind-bothering when we first got the letter because you got literature campaign and all of this other mumbo-jumbo I don't know who put into the agenda. But I came across a letter that Dr. Toback wrote when the Da Vinci Charter School was coming here, and I shared my experience with you what happened to me in the charter school, okay? Not all I in particular, but the charter school. Now, when I tried to take that matter to the state and to the county, it escalated in them telling me at their convenience, at their discretion, the charter school don't have to go by the rules of the state, which was a lie after I looked in a little further. And my thing is with this, my kid depends on a public school, and a bunch of other kids that I advocate for depend on a public school. But that being said, what scared me is when my son did go to the charter school and I experienced this thing that happened, it hurt me to my heart because it seemed more like segregation, and it reminded me of the Board Brown versus the Board of Ed, even up to the level when I got it in court. Everybody I watched at that last meeting stood at this microphone and said, if it don't work, I can get my kid and go somewhere else. I seen at least 40 people stood to this microphone and said that. And when I got home, it bothered me because I said, I wish I had the opportunity and the resources to say, if the public school system don't work for me, I could just leave with my child. And I've been seeing this happen in Hoboken. After the preschool 3 and 4 year old program, by the time the kid get in middle school, no one wants their kids with our kids. And it's scary. It is really scary. A speaker spoke at the same microphone and said, do me a favor, at dismissal time, go on the corner and watch Brant School at the 3 year old program and count how many Hispanic and African American students you see. It was not one. Right after that, I became a member, okay? And I'm in the agenda too, resigning tonight. And just like you, Mr. Garcia, they had me resigning before I resigned. But you can't get rid of Pat Wade, it's that easy. I am resigning, but in good standards, and it helps me promote and be more effective to my community because now it's not political. And I've learned to sit on a board and be control or be on a certain ticket, I have to be control. But thanks whoever put my resignation letter in, and I enjoyed serving the community in a 3 year program in the early childhood for 2 years. But with that being said, if you're gonna fight and advocate a school, and I read the letter from the Da Vinci letter, I refuse, and I live in this city, I advocate in this city to have anyone try to segregate this school system. Anyone. Okay, so if our kids is good enough to sit with them in the 2 and 3 year program and my son meet a little friend and hope he could walk through the high school, public school hallways with this little friend and only to get disappointed and say, well, mommy, wasn't that good enough? Imagine what we think and what we feel when we got to take and relocate and we just don't have the resources. We depend on the public school system. I will continue to advocate for the public school system, and I hope this don't bring no bitterness with nobody, because as an advocate, I do what's right. I seek to do the right thing. I don't seek sides. I don't sugarcoat nothing, and I'm calling it like I see it. This will leave open space for segregation. I'm wrapping it up, and I don't want that to happen, okay? And this is what I'm saying to you is, the Da Vinci letter spoke for itself, and my son's personal experience spoke for me. I need the public school system. So I'm concerned about every dime in the public school system. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pam.
Next,
Roseanne Versace.
Good evening, Roseanne Versace, fourth grade teacher, Wallace School. I stand here before you not as an opponent of the charter schools, but as a proponent and supporter of the Hoboken Public Schools. It is inconceivable how some would argue that the loss of funding from a public school budget does not have a negative impact on the district. Removing almost $8 million from any budget is sure to have an effect, and with respect to a school district that relies on public funds, it is impossible to meet this assessment without any repercussions. It is a parent's right to decide where their child should attend school, and I don't question anyone's choice. I simply struggle with why we should fund these schools when their results are damaging to us. Our public schools are a highly diverse community with a highly qualified and educated staff. I think we saw clear evidence of that tonight with Mr. Fitzhugh and his staff at Connor School, Mr. Munoz and his honor, the honor that he received, Mr. England as the athletic director, and Coach Taglieri and his football team. The teachers are passionate about their profession and care deeply about their students. These same teachers use their own funds to compensate for what the district may not be able to provide and do so willingly. The district on both the elementary and high school levels provides a wealth of resources for a small urban district and many services that are not otherwise available outside the public schools. One of the greatest advantages that the students have in Hoboken is that the class sizes are relatively small in comparison with other urban districts and even suburban districts, both near and far. By decreasing the funds made available to us, these numbers will not be sustainable. Although some would argue class size doesn't matter, as an educator, I can tell you it does, especially when you take into account some of the special needs that our students have. The larger the class size, the less individualized attention each student can be afforded. And when you consider those who are English language learners or the students who have special needs, the impact of a crowded classroom cannot be ignored. On the elementary school level, this is especially significant, particularly in the primary grades. In order to meet this assessment, other programs will suffer as well, such as the arts. Students from the fourth grade through the sixth grade in the elementary school are given the opportunity to learn to play an instrument and participate in the band at no cost to them for the actual instruments they play. This is not something that other districts have, and again, it's a service that may be compromised if funds are not available. Class trips are often organized with no cost to the students. Again, with the decrease in funds, opportunities such as these won't be possible. In sum, our district recognizes the needs of its students and does its very best to provide services and diverse academic and extracurricular activities to educate our students in the best way possible and to broaden the horizons of the students who might otherwise never have these opportunities. Therefore, I support Dr. Toback's letter to Commissioner Cerf and the Board of Education's resolution regarding the expansion of VOLA. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can we, any more speakers? Beth Tomlinson, please.
And just so everybody knows, our timer broke, so I'm timing here. Okay.
I promise to be short.
I'm sure you'll be fine, Beth.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. My name is Beth Tomlinson. I'm a kindergarten teacher at Brandt, and I have taught in this district both pre-K and K, and I've seen lots of children get their start in their educational paths. In Hoboken, both the pre-K and the kindergarten programs are excellent. We have dedicated staff that are committed to providing a quality, meaningful learning experience for all the students we teach. And in these grades, it is a very diverse mix. Kids from all over town utilize the pre-K and the kindergarten. And it's been a difficult but very rewarding experience. And I've had a lot of positive feedback from parents and students alike. And I'm always a little confused when so many students leave the Hoboken Public School District each year. All I'm arguing for is imagine if we could find ways for all of us to work together as a district instead of this divisiveness that really does take away from the common goal we all share, educating our children. Thank you.
Paul Huggins.
Hello, Paul Huggins. I'm an English teacher at Hoboken Junior Senior High School. I'm just here tonight to share a couple of my experiences over the past 10 years as an educator in Hoboken School District. And I ask that you consider this as you decide on your support for Superintendent Toback's request for the impact study as, with regards to the Hoboken Charter School expansion. I started here 10 years ago, approximately 10 years ago, and my very first year there was an opportunity to help get started a homework and tutoring lab at the time, and I was sort of strongly asked to participate with this, and I said, okay, yes, I will. At that time, there was really only a few students that were coming to the homework and tutoring lab, and we built up an incentive program. And over time, every year, we increased that program, the population that used it and utilized it. Today, we have students waiting outside for 3 o'clock to begin so they can come in every day and are disappointed if it's a snow day or a half day if they can't come in and use it. This is a place where, over the time, I've seen students that were headed down a wrong direction, that were didn't have a positive outlet after school, found programs in Hoboken High School, beyond the regular innovative instruction that happens in the classroom. I also have had the privilege of working as an AP teacher and writing the curriculum for the AP. And I've seen students come in who have always kind of had seemingly an easy time at grades, doing well, and I've seen them challenged, meet those challenges, and take ownership of their own education. Beyond that, I've also worked with the HESPA and SAT prep, all these programs that have really nurtured the learning environment in our school. One of the really great programs that we have is the SPI program, the Student Publishing Initiative. In this program, as I know you've seen probably the memoir book published, some students that really were not on the academic track when they began this started with a few words on a page and built that into a published memoir that they share with their classmates in a open reading. Where they share really sometimes very courageous and heartfelt stories, but they've learned what it's like to take something and mold it into something that is professional. I ask you to consider these sort of experiences as you look to support Dr. Toback's request. These might be endangered if resources are taken away from our school. And I do know that as educators, as board members, that we all want to educate and give the best and most effective education to all the students of Hoboken. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Gary Enrico.
Good evening. I'm in this district 38 years, so when you're in a district a long time, you have a lot of history. But Carmelo was in my homeroom. All right, and he did like to talk a lot, and he did get a detention numerous times from his homeroom teacher. But I figured he was going to grow up to be a politician, and he did. So I'm going to miss you. We didn't always agree on things, but you know, that's the way it is. Rose, you know, we had our ups and downs, but I really think your service to the children of Hoboken. Right. It was never personal on my end. It was just the job that I had. But let's get back to, I want to go to Dr. Toback's letter, and the board should support this. Okay. And like I said, when you're in a district a long time, you have a lot of history. When the charter school first got started, I think it was like 1987, 88, we had some board members who were very, very bright. And we actually rented space to the charter school. That's like McDonald's having Burger King in the same store and you're competing for the same customers. And that's something that's still going on today, which I find, I think about it when I'm outside the school, you know, it's unbelievable actually. But you as the Board of Education, you are elected to serve the public school children of Hoboken. And our superintendent, our very brave superintendent who has come forth with this proposal for the study, he is representing the public schools. The members of the charter school say they are public schools, but they are not. We have in a mile square, we have four schools, we have four separate districts, we have four separate administrative staff in a town that's a mile square. It's really unbelievable. We have so much repetition of service in a district. And as sitting on a Board of Ed, if you are on a Board of Ed for the public school, you have no other reason not to support it, because you represent the children of Hoboken, the public school children whose parents have elected to send their children to our public school. Would you be able to stand up at a charter school meeting and give them your opinion on how they should run their school? I don't think you'd be allowed to do that. All right, we have a lot of good things in Hoboken that we got. If the history going all the way back to when charter schools started, we were designated an Abbott district here because of the income of the people who live here. what we have now is kind of flip-flop. We have a high income, and people take advantage of all the services. They come into the pre-K, they come into the pre-K-4, they want those things because they feel they're entitled to it. So they get those services, and then when a kid starts going to kindergarten, they start pulling the children out, they opt into the charter school, which I don't know why, but they do that, and then if they have a child that has special needs or something, they then come back to the public school district. And Vito's very familiar with the challenges you have when people want certain, be sent to certain schools. So it just seems like, to me, anyway, it's all about money. And, you know, I just find it amazing. And before I retire, I want someone to tell me why they do not send their children to our public school. I want an answer from someone. I would love to sit down with them one night, anywhere they want to meet. I want someone to explain to me, what are we doing wrong? That you cannot, we have 650 students. That's $8 million goes out. If we were an inclusive district, we make one big school system, we hire 60 more teachers, because we're going to have all these kids back in, or 40 more teachers, at $60,000, that's $2.4 million. We keep $1 million, we upgrade the buildings. You can give the taxpayers back $4 to $5 million. So when people ask how you should cut the budget, that's basically the answer that I'm giving you. And it's an answer I think that you should give the public. We have great, highly qualified teachers. It's very rigorous to become a teacher in New Jersey right now. So we have a highly qualified staff. We have better facilities. And again, I want someone, before I retire, please come up to me and say, Gary, this is why we don't come here. Because I think I know the reason why. All right, I think I've stated it, but I don't want to go back over that. So someone get me an answer somewhere along the line. Could you do that? I appreciate it. And Dr. Torbeck, the association does support you fully and supports the board.
Thank you. Thank you, Gary.
Deidre Wall.
Okay, I'll wait. Is this the last speaker?
Yes, it is.
After the speaker, I'll be having a 5-minute break just so we could refresh ourselves, then we'll go to the agenda.
Hi. Good evening. Deidre Wall, 515 4th Street in Hoboken. I'm the parent of a grade 7 student in the junior-senior high school. I'd like to let you know how much I love our district, our superintendent, our administrators, our very dedicated teachers, our PTOs, our families, and our students, and the children who my son spends his days with learning, socializing, and growing. It is a district that my husband and I have chosen for the last 8 years, beginning in kindergarten at Wallace School. It is a district that I have watched improve, strengthen, and evolve with a strong plan and leadership from our superintendent, Dr. Toback, and the support of the public school board trustees, you. Dr. Toback understands that as the superintendent of the public school district, it is his duty and responsibility to advocate at all times and in all cases for the interests of the students in this district. And as a public school district parent, I expect nothing less from Dr. Toback and all of our public school board trustees. As the educational leader of our district, Dr. Toback must consider the implications of any school, charter school expansion on our district's ability to not only maintain its current level of programming, but our district's ability to continue to improve and to provide innovative and unique options to the students in our district as it currently is doing so now. If the state approves the expansion of OLA, our district will be faced with the impossible choice between cutting programming for our students or raising taxes. We, as parents, do not want to erode the steady improvements that are being made in the public schools. It is very unfortunate for our community that the state charter laws and the state charter funding formula set up a struggle that pits school district against school district. However, this is the reality we face until the state establishes new laws. Perhaps something for Mr. Garcia to pursue. It is also the reality that the state and the state alone will decide whether or not to grant OLA's expansion. OLA is representing the interests of its district as it should. Dr. Toback is representing the interests of the Hoboken Public School District as he should against any loss in funding. And you too, as Public Board trustees, should be supporting Dr. Toback and his letter. Please do your job and support Dr. Toback and the children of our school district as you have sworn to do so. And finally, I wish you all a good holiday, and just a thank you to our departing board members. Thank you.
We'll be taking a 5-minute break, then we'll bring up the agenda and people could address whatever things they want as the agenda items of their concern
Motion.
Is brought up. Okay. Motion. Okay, we're back in session. It's the holiday season, so I'm going to do the most optimistic thing in the world. I'm going to propose a consent agenda. So how's that? Great moments and wishful thinking.
Ho, ho, ho.
Okay.
It is wishful thinking. I would like to pull some items, please.
Okay. I'd like to separate some things, though.
Okay.
Yeah, if there are items that you just want clarification on that we can then vote on, I would like those first. You understand what I'm saying? I would like to be able to have a consent agenda, except for one or two things that might be on the, that we'll pull. So are your any of your questions about pulling something or just getting additional information?
No, additional information.
Okay, please, let's go on.
Okay.
Mr. Chair, I just need clarification on, can we comment and ask questions about the reports, like the superintendent's reports also at this time? Or
sure.
Where can we do that?
I mean,
we
definitely.
Can't, okay, because I have questions about that.
Okay,
thank
so why don't we, I it was my little
first.
What?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Why don't we first ask the questions about the report, obviously, and then we'll
okay,
go with the agenda.
In the report, you mentioned about Carmelo's term being up, and mm-hmm. he's going to be assemblyman. My question is, since he did not officially resign, is there a law, in fact, Vito may know this, that he has to resign? Since it's not, please, any clarification on that?
But I do plan to, Mr. Chairman. So
okay. Plan. No, but I just want, I
don't know
to be
where,
sure.
He,
how many seats can he?
Yeah, I don't want to have too many hats there.
Right. If you're right.
No man
if
is an island.
If your question, as I understand it, is does he have to resign simply because he's been elected, although he's serving in a different position, the answer is no.
Right.
And I don't think there was any suggestion that there's something right. wrong with him participating in this meeting. There certainly is not.
Right. No, but I mean, what, even being elected, once he's sworn in as an assemblyman, since this is not a paying elected position, would he have to, would anybody have to, not even him, anybody
You don't get
else?
Paid to sit on a board of education?
No, we don't. That's it. That's the reason.
So there's a law that was passed in the first year of Governor Christie's term
right.
that prevents people from serving on two different elected bodies. I don't think it makes a difference that you're not paid because it's okay. come up in a lot of school districts where people, let's say there's a K-8 school district and a regional high school district. There are a lot of places where people were serving on both boards. Those folks were grandfathered in, but the commissioner's office put a stop to that, saying that they thought that law applied to school districts. So without having researched this specific issue, my assumption is the answer is yes, that after he is sworn in, he wouldn't be able to serve in two positions. But since he's identified, that's not his intention anyway.
Right.
I don't think there's any problem whatsoever.
Right, because when that law was put into effect, I thought the reason was for the pension. People were double dipping into the pensions or triple dipping into pensions.
Yeah, that was the purpose of it. Although it applies to unpaid, there are actually mayors and council people in the state that serve without pay.
Right.
So the view of the commissioner's office is that it's not dependent on pay for the position, which is mm-hmm. why you can no longer serve on a regional school board and a local school board at the same time. Obviously, by definition, those positions aren't paid, but the Department of Education considers that law to apply to school officials as well.
Okay, great. Could you just find that for sure for me? If it's,
in fact,
I don't think there was any wiggle room in what I just
right.
said.
Mr. Chairman,
before
if I may, just to remind.
I think Mr. Carmel wants to clarify something.
Mr. Chairman.
Forgive me. I truly apologize. Mr. Garcia.
Thank you. You think about Carmelo Anthony. That's the best way to
okay.
remember who I am. But be that as it may, yeah, I just want to say, Mr. Chairman, and colleague Kearns, Rhodes Kearns, let me just say that for Mr. Gagliardi's sanity, definitely as much as you want to keep me here, you got to let me go. But I definitely do, as I've noted intend to, in January, submit an official resignation to the board secretary and the district. As much as I would love to just continue helping, I think I'm going to be more effective in the capacity in my assemblyman role and in working with the DOE and the commission and Commissioner Cerf. So this board, Mr. President, as I've noted earlier, and the superintendent will have me as an ally and advocate to ensure that we will fight for what resources we need for this district.
That's wonderful news. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Okay, any other questions till we can go to the agenda? Okay, the agenda. Please, which items are you
policy,
talking about?
The only policy, 7.01.
Okay.
I have a comment and a question, and of course I'm directing this towards you, Mr. Chair, but sure, Dr. Toback will have
7.01.
Okay. My comment, Dr. Toback, is in reviewing the agenda, reviewing the policy rather, I'm glad to see that if the teachers are being held accountable for student growth percentiles, and I'm happy to see the principal are as well. But my question is, the training that teachers and principals are going to go through, will that be done in-house, or does that have to go to an outside entity?
It's been done in a variety of different ways, but it already happened. It's long since passed. It was done during the summer. It was done last year. There's a variety of different sessions that took place for the teachers, for the principals. They've had extensive training.
And any trainings in the future would be done in-house, or it depends?
Most of it would probably be done, for example, the principal training. Mm-hmm. That's conducted by the New Jersey Association of the Principals and Supervisors Association. So they do that training. That's one benefit of the model that we have.
Right.
Okay. Generally speaking, it's a lot of times it's very helpful to have out-of-district trainers for this particular issue. So it depends on the circumstances. Some training we do in-house when we can handle it. In other cases, we do training. We've done a lot of training this year in-house with our administration. But for this particular issue for teacher evaluation, sometimes it's good for a person from the outside to come and explain a lot of things that we are explaining.
Great. Okay. Thank you. Can I move on to the next agenda?
Governor, I just had a comment.
About the 701?
The same one.
Okay.
Sure.
And I just wanted to take this opportunity, because Peter brought up, Mr. Biancamano brought up the training, to thank the administrators and the teachers, because it was a tremendous undertaking for all of them. The administrators passing tests and doing what they needed to do and studying, and also the teachers all had to learn the model too, and it's greatly appreciated, I'm sure, by the full board for all that hard work. Thank you.
Okay, please.
Okay, governance and personnel 9.07, regarding the approval of children of non-resident staff to attend Hoboken Public Schools. I looked at the policy where this falls under, Dr. Toback, and I was just wondering, will the district be charging tuition for these students?
No.
No, because it's up to you, basically, to...
But the district has a past practice of allowing non-resident staff member or non-resident students or the children of staff members to attend the schools without cost. So you could try to do that, but then you have the retro
past
effect
price, right,
of all the other people that have not
been
charged.
I'm just curious because the policy wasn't too clear. Thank you. And then finally, governance and personnel 9.13, approval of students for school choice status.
Yes.
I noticed that there's a pre-K 4 student on here, and I was just curious, do we have any slots for choice students in pre-K 3 and 4?
No. Sorry. What we have is a pre-K 4 student who would like to be a school choice student starting next year in kindergarten. So we have the board approved four slots for kindergarten students for next year. This would be one of those slots, one of those placements.
Nice. Okay, but there is no choice students in pre-K.
We have no pre-K.
That's what I thought.
School choice. We do allow, remember, the Department of Ed and the pre-K program are kind of a little, they're a separate operation to some extent. So the question is the student allowed to stay? First of all, that would be disruptive to the student to have them go and then come back. And two, Department Ed, that's allowable. It's already a funded seat, so it's okay, based on the fact that they're continuing their education here as kindergartners.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chair?
Any other questions?
Same question. On the staff, I think that's a nice courtesy that we extend, that their children could attend school here where they work in the district. I just have a concern when their students do come here, and you know as well, better than most of us, how many parents do like to choose a school, whether it be Wallace, whether it be Calabro, mm-hmm. residents of the town. Mm-hmm. Could would they get a preference, like a residential preference over the outside placement for a school? If the teacher worked in Wallace, say, and that student came to Wallace, but there's a resident in our town whose student, whose child wants to come to Wallace, and maybe it's filled up.
It's a hypothetical situation.
Right. I just want to know, do we have something like that where, because they're a resident, that they would get priority?
No.
No. So the staff child could be put in Wallace before a residence? That's my question. Well, is that possible, that could happen?
It depends. For example, if the person from the community came the day after.
Okay.
We're talking about a hypothetical situation here, so there's really no reason to debate about a hypothetical
situation.
No, I'm
not debating. I'm just saying, like, if this could happen. It could happen, because it happens.
Theoretically,
I mean, you know that. I tell them to call you. They'll ask me, parents.
Theoretically,
It's
possible.
Okay.
But unlikely.
Right. But there's nothing like a policy. We don't have a policy where it says you're a resident, so you get a priority.
This is a private discussion, please.
Probably there's not too many districts in the state that have a policy like that. So I would say that it is, I guess, theoretically possible, but very unlikely.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. I'm going to ask that we vote on 9.16 separately. So which is Dr. Toback's letter that I'm taking out of the agenda, so that's going to be voted on separately. Does anybody have anything else they want to have voted separately?
No.
Nope?
Wasn't the old rant 12?
Do you want to separate or
no,
just vote
no?
Yes or no?
Could
vote no on that one.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
Okay. I'm going to ask for a consent agenda on everything but 9.16.
Move it.
Second.
Okay. Please call the roll.
Who motioned, please?
Motion.
Who motioned? Was it
Mr. Garcia.
Mr. Garcia. And seconded?
Ms. Sullivan.
Mr. Biancamano?
Aye.
Mr. Garcia?
Yes.
Mr. Klufel?
Yes.
Ms. Markle?
On finance agenda 12.02, no. Yes for everything else.
Ms. McAllister?
No on 12.02, yes on everything else.
Ms. Mitchell?
No on item 12.02, yes on everything else.
Mrs. Rhodes Kearns?
I just want to see what 12.02 is. Can somebody tell me quickly?
Modification.
Oh, the grant for, okay. Yes.
Yes on all. Recorded. Ms. Soboloff?
Yes on everything, no on 12.02.
And Dr. Gold?
Before I vote, I want to say it is very, very difficult and painful to take money out of one district and give it to another. However, this was a favor that Commissioner Cerf asked of us, and I think that it will at least show our willingness to be team members and to recognize that sometimes you should consider the thought processes and direction of our state superintendent. So it's a very painful vote for me, but I am going to vote yes. So it passes. Okay. Now we have 9.16. I move that we have a vote on it.
Second.
Motion was Mr. Clifford.
What?
You moved it? As a second.
I moved. Second.
Mr. Clifford, second. Moved by the board president.
Second.
Okay, this is.
Are we allowed to make comments before?
Oh, yes. That's why I have it separate. Now we can talk about it. This is Dr. Toback's letter, which I'll summarize, says he does not believe, and a number of us, we'll see how we vote, that OLA should be granted their extension prior to a study being done by the state. That's a fair summary of it?
Yes.
Okay. Please, the table's open for discussion now.
Are we starting right to left, or?
Who wants to make a comment before we vote?
Well, I'd like to just make a comment right before I vote. I don't know if we're just doing that.
Start with people will make their comments as we're voting.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay.
Mr. Biancamano?
So I make my comment?
Sure.
Okay.
Comment and vote.
First of all, I just want to make one thing clear. This is a non-binding resolution tonight. Whatever we decide at this dais, Commissioner Cerf is still going to vote on it, whether we vote for this resolution or not. And I believe it was Ms. Tomlinson that came up and said that, talked about this divisiveness. And to me, this letter causes divisiveness. I look at Hoboken Junior Senior High School, and we have great teachers, absolutely fantastic teachers. In our whole district, we have fantastic teachers. But I'm specifically looking at Hoboken Junior Senior High School, and our enrollment is a big problem there. Great teachers, great programs, but our enrollment is a problem there. There's just over 500 students, and just over 400 are residents of Hoboken, who take out the choice students. When it comes to school choice, I'm worried because, as I spoke about with Dr. Toback this morning, the state might want to put a cap on that, and I'm concerned that our enrollment's going to even decrease with the cap. So at the last meeting, we had a number of OLA parents come up and say that they're not going to put their children in our schools if we don't try to cooperate with them. And by sending a divisive letter, I don't see how cooperation can exist. So I'm going to vote no on the letter that Dr. Toback's writing to the commissioner for the simple reason that we need to try to fill our high school with as many students as possible. And by causing a greater rift between our charter schools and our public schools, I don't see that happening in the future, and everything else is going to increase the budget and things like that. Thank you.
Mr. Garcia?
Oh, great. Just what I want to say is, you know, I appreciate the teachers, as I do believe that their impact in the classroom has no effect on what is presented here this evening, because they do a tremendous job in educating our students. And in turn, it seems to me many of the words used, and I thank Beth and Roseanne and those folks that came up and spoke with respect to addressing the opponent versus proponent and divisiveness versus togetherness. The reality is, and when you speak about the $8 million, we're talking about all the charter schools, not just OLA. So the clarity of that, for me, putting it in perspective, is very simple. When we talk about education, and I think, Beth, you really hit the nail on the head, and it's not about opponents versus what we all want to be proponents towards, a good, a strong, effective educational system for the city of Hoboken. And as we mourn and celebrate the loss of one of our greatest leaders, President Mandela, who said it best, education is the greatest weapon to change the world. So for me, it's all about that student receiving the greatest education possible. And I will be abstaining from this vote. Thank you.
Mr. Klufel?
I have nothing to add other than a complete endorsement of Dr. Toback's suggestions and recommendations in the letter. I have no problem endorsing that. I vote yes.
Ms. Markle?
I have and I always will support the students in this district. And Mr. Garcia mentioned the mayor's letter where you say it will build bridges. I've read that letter, and Lord knows, maybe you might want to read that again. There are no bridges being built. The mayor works for all, not just one. And the separation is already there. Those parents said it right out. They'll never use the school if they don't. Every letter I received was, I'm going to move out. And Dr. Toback, I've always supported you. Yes.
Ms. McAllister?
Okay. I didn't say everything I was going to say about Ms. Markle because I thought she'd get really mad at me, but I'm going to say everything I wanted to say about this. This morning at 6:30, I was fortunate, unlike many of the teachers here, to be at home still, and I was able to listen to President Obama's remarks at Nelson Mandela's service. And what he said, and it struck home right away with me, is he said, it always seems impossible until it is done. And that was what Nelson Mandela lived by. And Dr. Toback wrote an impact statement about what needed to be addressed, and already what seemed impossible is happening this Friday. because he has put together a meeting with the directors of the charter schools to discuss the demographic issues between the four districts in Hoboken. And to me, that proves that the letter had impact and is already working. Dr. Toback has, my hope would be that this same committee would take on the second issue of funding and address the state together to ensure that the funding formula is changed, that the expansion of one district does not adversely impact another. This impact statement does exactly what it is required to do, addresses the impacts that the old expansion will have on our district. It requests that the Department of Education look at the impacts and act to eliminate them. I hope that when the Department of Education evaluates the OLA application, that they look at these issues and act so that we do not have to cut programming for our children. Many things were tossed out without really any kind of understanding of our budget last month about what we should, and have been told to us in emails about where they think our budget can be cut. And we know what we're doing, and if I can find cuts in our budget, I want to continue to fund and help our teachers, help our children, and have more programs here. So with that, I vote yes.
Ms. Mitchell?
Did you say Mitchell?
Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry. Yes, I'm supporting my superintendent. Last month, I stated I appreciated all the parents from OLA coming out to support their school. There's no question about OLA's passion and the value that's held to their district. But to deny that the expansion of OLA to the eighth grade would not have an impact on our public school district would be disingenuous. I'm concerned about the increasing demographic differences between our districts, and I don't think the existing lottery system is working well for our community. I agree with Dr. Toback that there should be a study done on these issues, and the status quo makes for an unbalanced community. Thank you.
Mrs. Rose Kearns.
First, I do want to say that we are not in a position, the board, to put a block on Dr. Toback when it comes to this application. Am I correct on this? Because there was a statement made that we can put a block on Dr. Toback, his input on this application for the expansion of OLA. We cannot do that.
Well, I'm not sure that I fully appreciate the question, but if your question is, could the Board of Education prevent Dr. Toback from sending this letter? Of course,
the application process. He is part of it for this expansion. Is he not with the Commissioner of Education? He has to have his input about
the impact statement.
And we have absolutely, we cannot stop him from doing that.
I believe if a majority of the Board of Education directed the superintendent to send no letter or a different letter, he works for you and you could do that.
But doesn't he, as the superintendent, have to do an impact for the commissioner?
He has to do an impact statement, but he works
for
the Board of Education.
Not maybe a specific one, but he has to do one, correct?
That's correct.
Okay, that's part of the application process. I just want to make sure that I'm clear on that.
I really don't understand the question.
It's part of the application process. He has to have an input in it, doesn't he?
The superintendent of schools has the right to submit a statement as to the impact of a proposed charter school or an expansion of the school. I understood your question to be, can the board have an impact on the impact statement? And the answer is, of course, he works for you. If you think if you disagree with the statement, you are free to preclude him from sending it. And that's what I think the board's vote is about.
Okay. I always feel that OLA was a missed opportunity for this district. I feel that having them as part of the district would have increased the enrollment in our schools, and therefore we would have had more funding for the school district. I was hoping that the dialogue was going to continue with OLA. I had asked to be a part of that meeting. The meeting took place, and I was never notified of the meeting taking place. And I asked in a public forum. I would have liked to have been there. I don't know what the meeting entailed, how it turned out, if you're going to continue dialogue with them. I would hope so, because I'll say it again. What Assemblyman Ramos said at the last meeting made the most sense. Conversations need to start taking place now if we would like to see them, this program, in our seventh and eighth grade. And that's what they had mentioned that they would like to see also, which would increase the enrollment in our school. So I'm hoping you do continue the dialogue, and I would like to see it as part of a program in our high school. And I would like to see it expand and be a part of ours. So I am voting no for this impact letter.
Ms. Soboloff?
Hi. I received a lot of communications in the past couple of months and for two very different sets of parents. Both of them really, really love their children. Both of them are very anxious about their school's ability to expand and progress and survive. And that's a good thing. We want a lot of interested parents in Hoboken. And I think it was interesting to hear from Ola, and I think it was mentioned last month that those voices came here, but it really is the state's purview to vote on this. And I think that everybody should go and speak to the state and write to the state, the public parents as well as the charter parents, because they are a separate district, and that is by choice and design. I feel like sometimes there's a little confusion about that. Parents and come together and petition the state to allow them to create a separate district. And their boards are just the same as our boards. They hire a superintendent, they set policy, and it is their duty, I believe, to advocate for their students, and I respect that, and I hope that people would respect my duty to advocate for my students. And we can all agree that it's an imperfect situation, and the state okays a new charter or okays the expansion of a new charter, but they don't ever consider the funding, and there is no additional funding. It must come out of this budget, out of the existing local school budget. And that's why I believe that our superintendent can and should submit this letter of impact, and the funding of one district should not come from another. Because we know there's only two sources of income, either a tax increase, and I know that some people believe that everyone in the community is willing to support a tax increase, excuse me, for greater choice. And I don't know, some people I've met have said yes, some no. I also know from many of my emails that a lot of families in the OLA community believe that the cuts to our students will be, in their words, negligible. And at approximately $500,000, I don't believe that that's negligible, but that's their opinion. And it as a board trustee of this district, it is my honor and duty to advocate for the parents and the students and the staff of this district, and I would be concerned about anything that was going to impact in any way our growth, our progress, and our ability to move forward. So with that, I support the superintendent's letter to the state, who they will ultimately make the decision.
Recorded as a yes. Dr. Gold.
Taking money from a district that needs money, I always viewed as a little strange, but there are only two possible outcomes to the OLA expansion. We will be forced to cut the budget that supports the education of our city's neediest kids, or will be forced to raise the local levy on our already overburdened taxpayers. Make no mistake about it, that's it. Mm-hmm. And this decision will be painful enough, but everybody talks, but it will be the members of this board, not the mayor, not the city council, not anyone on the boards of the charter schools, who have to answer to the children, the families, and the taxpayers over this, and I stress it, this unfortunate result of a flawed state policy, that I must vote yes.
Motion carries.
We have now, anybody signed up for the public portion?
I do have.
Yeah, that's what.
That's, I do.
Yes.
Excuse me.
Wait, please. We finished the agenda. Now people are going to talk about whatever they want to talk about.
Oh,
you can talk now.
Sure.
Yeah, we have one individual. It's Ms. Waiters.
Oh, Ms. Waiters is signed up.
Oh,
you're
okay.
Signed up, Patty.
Both of you are signed up. We've never been on formalities before.
So that'll make two speakers.
Good evening, everybody. How are you today?
Great.
My name is Angel Quinones. I'm a parent of three beautiful children in this beautiful town. I'm very, very excited that everybody voted in the letter from Mr. Toback. It's been very mind-boggling after I've been hearing about this situation for the past month. I haven't been able to concentrate at work, thinking what my children can suffer in the near future, and some of our best teachers in this town as well can suffer because they might lose their job. I mean, let's point that out as well. It is to our benefit. We, in this bad economy that we live in today, myself, a stay-home dad, lost my job after 13 years. I cannot afford to send my kids to Ola. I would like to do that, but of course we cannot do that, or to a private school or to a charter school. And maybe back then I was able to do that. But you know, all I'm saying, you know, all in all, our public school system is working in Hoboken. The gentleman Peter mentioned earlier that he sees the decrease, or he has a question about the enrollment, how it's not increasing or decrease. Right, the classrooms, you know, we need to look into that instead of taking money from our pockets and giving it to somebody else. So I think that we should really, I'm glad that everybody's together on this, and, you know, we all voted yes. I told Mr. Tolbeck at the pizzeria in the corner, I'm going to be here today. I'm going to support that letter because my kids are doing wonderful, straight-A students, and some of their teachers are here today. They can tell you that. We work very hard with our kids, and I think public school work. OLA is a great program. I'm not against it, but they should figure something else out. You know, call Eli Manor or something to give you some money. I don't know. He's in town. Thank you.
All right, Angel.
Patricia Waiters. Is there anybody else? How many other speakers?
One other individual after Patricia Waiters. It's Vito Gagliardi.
Okay.
Patricia Waiters. Again, I don't want to be misinterpreted with the statements that I made earlier, but right before you voted, Peter mentioned enrollment, and then somebody else, another board member, mentioned the lottery process. I'm going to share real brief with you the lottery process. It was the coldest day of the year. I walked on Washington Street, 7 blocks, to get to the lottery, and something that we really can't prevent. In the room, I was the only African-American. So I'm saying to myself, this is going to be like playing the Mega Million. I put my name in the hat that in advance they shook the big basket and put all the numbers on the board where whatever number matched your ticket, that's where your child will be placed. And that's what your last letter mentioned, which was true. It's really hard, and I'm calling it like it is, to say we're going to get a fair and open process. Whether you create a lottery, a picket, whatever you want to call it, the way you enroll the kids is going to cause an impact. Now, all the names come out, and I'm looking around, 87% of the people standing there is Caucasian, 1% African-American, and probably 2% Hispanic. They shake the bucket. I came out first. If you could see the look on their face, because Wallace is Irish, they didn't know my son was Raphael Wallace, and they put the numbers out on the board, like from first to last to whatever. So they said, go up and match your number. When I came from the back after I found my way through the crowd, I said, that's me up here on the top. They said, you sure? I said, yes, look. 16723, whatever Ralph was, that's my son. So now my daughter automatically go because his siblings, and they're like, what do we do? You see? So you gotta be real careful to what you wish for. And I'm just giving an example, because then when I went down to the fourth ward where all the African Americans, I said, why y'all didn't come out? Y'all made me walk 8 blocks to go. We ain't got a chance. If you go look in the room, our name coming out is like a miracle. I said, well, I just created a miracle tonight because we number one on the list to go to the charter school. And they attended both charter schools. So I'm not standing up here, and it shouldn't be a fight to fight which charter school is this and what's going to happen this and who's mad and who's defending who. We just want a system that works. And my kids wind back up in the public school and it's working. My daughter's doing great in the high school. My son's doing great over here in Wallace. And when he went to OLA, it wasn't a lottery process. He cut the ribbon, right, Mr. Garcia? Standing right on it, he cut the ribbon, and he was first there, too. So it has nothing to do with making this a fight. I want our kids to all go to school together, in unity, get an education, and be friends. That's what I want. Yeah. Thank you. And now I'm wrapping it up. In this newspaper article, I have it. I'm letting you all know, because I'm talking to some board members, and they didn't receive it. I did put in an application for your seat. Not that I'm trying to rush you away, Mr. Garcia. But I got the thing right here. I said, please contact me when received. So evidently the board members didn't receive it. But real quick, I put my interest in, this is just a letter, my resume gonna follow, from Patricia Waiters candidate. I am a strong activist and advocate for the children of Hoboken. My constant attendance at the Board of Ed meeting shows my loyalty to the children of this system. My interest in the Board of Ed lies solely within my heart. I'm not trying to satisfy anybody's political agenda for power or control, so I will be applying for that upcoming vacant seat on January 2014. I will continue to advocate for the parents, the administration, and the children of Hoboken. We finally, excuse me, in closing, we need a minority to on this board to serve the community properly and fairly. In closing, I hope that we will be fair and open, and the process will be fair to the people that apply for this position. I'm looking forward to being interviewed, and I will attend the next meeting to express my candidacy. Thank you. And you all should get one in your emails.
Thank you.
And you too, Dr. Toback. Thank you. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Motion. And congratulations.
Wait, isn't there one more? Wait, veto. There's veto.
Oh.
No, veto.
Veto. I've heard it.
Do I time veto?
I think we have to
time. Be brief. Vito Gagliardi. I take this extraordinary step to say something respectful to two of the board members who were here when I was first retained as the attorney for this district 4.5 years ago. I thank them both for their service, and to Mr. Garcia, I say briefly, I think people can only appreciate where you're going if they understand where your journey started. And I congratulate you on the next step of your public service.
Thank you, Mr. Gagliardi.
To Ms. Markle, I say this. 82 years after my grandfather arrived in this very city, 16 years old, penniless, and marginally literate, I arrived here as the attorney for this Board of Education. I think my grandfather's struggles to make it in this country would have been so much easier if he had someone with your wisdom and dedication and spirit to guide him the way you welcomed and guided me. And I thank you for your service as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I make a motion that the meeting be closed.
Move
second.
It.
Second.
Thank you.